first of all, I thank the head metallurgical engineering IAEST Shibpur for inviting me to give a talk on this occasion. And so based on various considerations, I thought I will keep my talk on somewhat theme-based, but it should be a little bit spread over different materials because people from different specializations may be in the audience, and particularly the students work on different materials. So based on this, the talk has been aimed at focusing the importance of understanding texture and microtexture in materials, and to explain the different responses exhibited by differently textured materials or materials having different types of texture and microtextures. And the responses I have considered in a widespread domain, mechanical, chemical, biological, because this works quite well these days in the area of interdisciplinary research. So in this category, I have four examples. One, I will tell about fracture behavior of magnesium alloy. Second example, I will give how dwell-fatigue debit in titanium alloy, which is a very important problem now, is addressed by understanding texture and microtexture, right? And third is biological response of the material, how a titanium, which is also an important biomaterial, how control of texture and microtexture can affect that. And lastly, I will touch upon a little bit about nanosurfaces of nanostructured material. And there also, I will try to prove the same thesis that it is a better control of microstructure, microtexture, and texture that leads to better performance of the material. So with this, I move on to just little bit of idea, because I will be using these terms quite often. We know that hexagonal materials deform through various slip modes, because the slip modes are restricted in a fashion, but there are other possibilities under different conditions. So I particularly like to draw your attention on few things. One is basal slip, prismatic slip, the slip planes are marked and slip directions are also marked here. And other important thing is this tensile twinning. So the twinning takes place on this plane, one bar.
You're very sorry to interrupt you, but the slides are not changing if you give us the permission to speak.
Okay, so it's fine that you told me. So I don't know how to do it. So I'm still in the first slide.
Yes, sir. You're still in the introductory slide containing the logo of IASC.
Now also?
Yes sir, no change yet.
My God, so how to do this?
Sir, try sir. Pressing F5. Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Sir, try pressing F5 and using the direction keys.
Okay, F5. It doesn't work here.
Sir, or another thing maybe you can do is you can email it to Professor Manojit Ghosh, and okay. We can take it.
That I am doing now immediately. Okay. Just bear with me. Now it's not there. Christ. Okay, fine. So reply. taking some time for upload. Okay, so now it goes.
Dear participants, please stay with us while we resolve this technical issue.
I have already sent the slides. Please let me know when you are able to download them.
Yes, sir.
But this is an unusual problem because we are doing this every day with Microsoft Teams. I don't know how it has happened.
Sir, Professor Ghosh is asking which email ID have you forwarded it to?
Head Metallurgical.
Okay. Yes, sir, we have received your presentation. May I please seek your permission to present now?
Yes, sure. Please go to the second slide where you stopped. I suppose the second slide was the one where it was stopped. Right? The contents, it's written contents.
Okay. Is my screen...
Yeah, your screen is, I'm not able to see. Reminiscence, metallurgy, no. But anyway, I can move the slide, no problem. I have my slides on my desktop. So I will be telling the contents and you can keep moving it.
Yes, sir, that can be
right.
Done. That
so
can
now
be done.
We are on the contents. So. I would like to give four examples. Now we have lost a little bit of time, but I will try to cover it up. Mm-hmm. So we have I have collected four examples that will demonstrate how texture and micro texture are important to explain the mechanical behavior, chemical response, and biological response of the material. So the first example will be on magnesium, which I will go to the next slide, where before we get into magnesium, I just would like to draw the attention of particularly the young learners that I am going to talk about some slip systems and twin, though I would like to keep it to a very general level. So one important thing is all these hexagonal materials which will be discussed today, they deform primarily by basal slip and some prismatic slip. And there is also activation of some type of twinning. So tensile twin, which is indicated by TT in the bottom row of the diagrams in the middle. So tensile twinning is very important, and I will show you that how beautiful this tensile twinning explains some very important phenomena in magnesium. Now in the next slide, I will just go to explain about the fracture behavior of magnesium. Now why fracture behavior is of magnesium is important, that is shown in the next slide, where there are some pictures shown about automotive bodies. So there has been a dream of people. There has been a dream of people to explain to use magnesium in automobiles. And big companies like General Motors and Chrysler's, and they have been constantly working on replacing steels or other heavier components by magnesium alloys, because magnesium shows typically very good strength, good specific strength. So if you see, there is a need, if you use magnesium components in automobile, there is a need for having improved formability and fracture resistance. So the second part that mentions in the middle, there has been a lot of activity in all three points, like thinner wall casting, formability and fracture resistance, and lower cost galvanizing corrosion treatments. But here I will emphasize on the fracture part of it, and we will see that in the next slide. In the next slide, we will see, right?
Sir, I've provided you the control.
Okay. Then in the next slide, we see how fracture can be related to various phenomena that take place in titanium. We have seen, result of an experiment by one of my colleague who has become my collaborator in this investigation. They carried out some experiments where they have cut the notch of in single crystal magnesium, and they realized that at the leading edges, as you will see here, the twins coming in from outside, that the tensile twin nucleation occurs at the loading edge here, and that it grows towards the notch root, right? And this is an important dissipation mechanism as identified by them. Well, I am unable to move this slide. Can I move? Okay, the next slide shows the investigation carried out by some other investigator, because the previous slide was on a single crystal magnesium. But as all of us know that for any engineering component, unless specifically designed, mostly we deal with polycrystalline material. And fracture behavior of polycrystalline material, owing to its engineering importance, has been investigated by some very good researchers, and they have come up with a proposition that, as shown here, they have come up with a series of mechanisms, and they say that as we can see in the right hand side of this slide, that there is a grain, and the crack tip, once it goes in a group of grains, it creates a there is a plastic zone ahead of the crack tip, and in the plastic zone there is a formation of deformation twins, and along the sides of deformation twin there is a dislocation pileup, and as the crack propagates, these dislocations act as a facilitator to crack propagation into the boundary. And by this mechanism, which is based on the experimental observation on the left-hand side of the micrographs, the micrograph shown in the left-hand side, it clearly shows that the crack blunting takes place at 35 at a mean distance of 35 micron, and the, once the crack forms, it grows along the twin boundary, which is shown in the fine red lines over here. And the K1C that was calculated for this experiment, because this was done under tension, normal tension condition. So the fracture toughness K1C that was calculated was 22 MPa square meter, right? And this was the samples had, they were initially extruded alloys, and they had average grain size of 52 microns, and these were fatigue pre-cracked specimen. The next slide. Can we go to the next slide? Right.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Right. Actually, I'm, even though you have given me control, but probably you have to assist me by moving the slides, because I am unable to.
No problem. You will just say next slide and I will move on to the next one.
Thank you. Thank you. So now here I am showing you that we have taken. So in the case of Somekawa, he has taken a extruded material which has some kind of a weaker texture, or but normally in most of the cases when magnesium is used, it is used in hot rolled condition. And in the rolled condition, magnesium forms a strong basal texture. So this is the magnesium that we took for investigation, because we also wanted to match with the simulations of Professor Narasimhan, which was done on single crystal basal oriented magnesium. And this very clearly shows that most of the grains are having near basal orientation. We carried out an experiments with a CT specimen geometry, which is shown in the top right of the slide. And with this, CT tension experiments were carried out. Thickness was 10 meters, and the notch diameter was about 90 microns, and the ratio 8W ratio was 0.4. Grain size, in this case, the beautiful thing was the grain size was lower than what was used by Somekawa. So 14 micron grain size was there. And those who are not familiar with the basal texture, there is a schematic shown below this micrograph, which shows that in a basal textured material, the unit cells of the material or unit cells of this hexagonal material will be oriented like this. In the next slide, please. Next slide.
Yes, sir. I have actually gone to the next slide, but it's getting updated now.
Okay. Fine. Now it's there. Right. So the microscopic response of CT specimen tests was like this, and this is the load versus CMOD curve for RD and TD directions, because the samples, we extracted samples from both the directions, along rolling direction as well as along transverse direction, but both the cases basal plane was normal to the sample plane. So in those cases, the load versus this crack mouth opening displacement curve is here. It is shown for TD and RD here, and they look very similar, and they show some nonlinear behavior for about P more than 5 kilonewton case, and they also show high hardening. The peak load appears at about comes to be about say 9.1 kilonewton, and if we plot this J versus in the right side, the J versus P curve is shown from the elastic estimates. So here P is also more than 5 kilonewton. So it is very clear that the crack initiation close to takes place close to the peak load on the specimen surface, and it is followed by stable crack growth. And the J at peak load was measured to be about here in this case about 46 newton per millimeter. That comes out to be 48 megapascal root meter, and this is almost two times what Somekawa has observed, as I have shown in the two slides back. So next slide, please.
Yes, sir, updating.
Right. Right. So we first examine whether there is some issue with the material, that something, some reinforcing phase is leading to a strengthening or better fracture toughness of this material. So we have compared the fractographs of our material and Somekawa's material. So these are the top ones are ours, and the bottom single photograph is Somekawa. And we have seen that the SEM fractographs of our material, it shows dimple fracture, and there is no evidence of cleavage in this case. There are some particles which probably came during the material preparation itself. It shows some amount of oxides here. And these are some particles which are embedded in the void, but overall the fracture pattern is dimple type. And we have seen that there is significant notch blunting at about 200 micron grain size, 200 micron size. So that is about, if you compare the same thing in corresponding to Somekawa's fractographs, so it's about 4.5 times more than Somekawa. This significant notch blunting has taken place at 4.5 times more than what Somekawa has observed. And EDS has shown pure manganese particles in the dimple here. So, and then our results have shown, the fracture patterns have shown very similar to what was reported in another paper, which was more recent than when we started this work, Kondori and Benzerga, who has explained this higher fracture toughness in this material based on the stress triaxiality. So the next slide.
Yes, sir, updating.
So the examination of the surface of this CT specimen very clearly shows that there is a large scale yielding in the material, and then there is a finger-like region on the left side at the top. One can see that there is a finger-like region which consists of twin bands, which can be seen in the adjacent picture. If carefully we see here, there are lines which reflect twins here, but these are like finger type patterns. They originate from the free end or the other end of the material, and they try to converge towards the crack tip, right, in the uncracked ligament here. In this case, it's very clear. And then this optical micrograph near this region, like tip of this finger, very clearly shows the tip. It very clearly shows, which is shown here, it clearly shows that there is a twin formation here in this case, in these regions. So the material is heavily twinned. So next slide, please.
Yes, sir, updating.
Right. So we had this idea that there is something to do with the micro texture of this material. So we did EBSD of this, and we saw that there is indeed numerous twin formation, and there is a very systematic trend in twin formation in the material as we go from the one end to the other. So here in the key figure, we can see that at one end where B is written, at the other end of the material, and then A is the crack tip here. So from B side, so mid plane at the A place, that in this area where there is some kind of a curved arrows are shown. So it shows at the mid plane of the sample, it shows thick tensile twins of which has a plane of 10/12. And we can see here blue twins, blue patterns are very clear, and they are at the there are twins in the free surface. There are more that, and the mid plane a little less, but here it, free surface is here, the second picture, and first top one is the mid plane. We can see that there is more number of twins in the free surface here in the second one than this, but in both the cases, more or less there is formation of numerous amount of twins. And there are very interesting things that we have seen. In this case, the twins cross the grain boundaries also. The arrow tip shows there is a continuous chain of twin across the grains. We can see that there is a grain boundary here where Q is written, and the grain below also has the same twin is propagating in the grain below. Similarly, in the grain marked O, also there is a continuous twin formation irrespective of the grain boundary. So it just follows across the grain. Similarly, at the free surface also we can see, and here we can also see twin-twin interaction, like the place where L is written, twin-twin intersection. So we can see that two twins coming from two different directions, they are interacting with each other. And then we also see that there is a coalescence of twins in the region M here at the bottom, with twins of the same variance, they coalesce together and they become broad. So they look like as if the entire grain is covered like this. In the region B, which is the extreme side of, which is the other side of the notch, we could see that there is a free surface. At the free surface, there is a tensile twinning, profuse tensile twinning. And then we can see that the twins grow at such a faster rate that these tensile twins engulf the grains. Like some of these, the arrows indicate, if you carefully look at it, the green grain or this yellow grain or the top, the grain number B. So they all show as if B and G are, G is here, that green grain, and B is here, that blue long grain. So the tensile twinning, they engulf the full of the grain. And then twinning related hardening mechanism must be operative in this case. And then it is very clear after examining this free surface microstructure or microtexture that there is a significant dissipation that could occur due to tensile twins over the entire ligament. Twins are omnipresent, the variation, trend, interaction being different from one geometrical region to the other. Next slide, please.
Yes, sir, updating.
Yeah, so now here we can see here the same thing, the same area, the crack tip has been enlarged here. You can see here, this is the crack, the dark ones are looking crack, and we can see the KLMN region, KLMN region, and we can see very nicely that crack is propagating in this direction from left to right, and there is a series of twins in an arc form. Twins form in different grains at the same location and they form some kind of an arc as if they are stopping the grains, stopping the crack to propagate further. So there is, but of course this is a result of stress state in the grains, but they make a cover of that. And then the twin regions, in this case, this is the inverse pole figure of, this is the state at the mid surface. Now let's go to the next slide.
Updating, sir.
Right, yeah. We have to live with this. Right. Now here we can very clearly see it is the free surface picture. So again, this region we can see the whole red grains which were there in the initial material, because of the twin formation, and twin growth, the entire grain has become, entire surrounding of this crack has become blue. So there is an orientation change of the entire material, and this was also very clearly noticed in the pole figure near the crack tip, that initially if you see the top pole figure, it was basal means all red grains, and at the crack tip if we calculate these pole figures, it's complete change in the pole, in the texture here, and then the whole thing has become blue. Blue means the orientation changes to 10/10 type. So this is very, very dramatic or drastic change. And this is all the result of the formation of twins, because this is the orientation of twins that we generally see. The twins grow at such a faster rate that the whole orientation changes. So now we had a very clear evidence that at free surface there is more effect of reorientation as a result of twinning. This also of course occurs at the mid surface. Anywhere near the crack tip there is a twin formation, and that leads to reorientation. And then this hardening induced by reorientation can strongly retard microvoid growth, which is a part of the next study, which I am not going to present here, but this was also verified. This was a speculation that we got from this study, and it was later on verified through some other modeling initiatives, modeling related works. And then we also could very clearly say, which nobody had said by then, that tensile twinnings play a dual role in imparting the fracture resistance. One is that they account for significant dissipation in the background plastic zone, microvoid growth and coalescence due to operation of various hardening mechanisms in the region surrounding the fracture process zone near the notch root. Now, next slide, please.
Updating.
I will use my own slides. Okay, so we calculated this fracture behavior. We did quantitative estimation, and by all this simulation work, which came as a result of experimental determination of twinning, we could estimate that the contribution of twinning to energy release rate at the load P equals to 8.7 kN is about 22 Newton per millimeter, which is about 70% of the total J at this stage. So a large contribution is done by twinning. So twinning plays a very, very significant role. And so the crack initiates. So if the material is favorably oriented, then if the crack propagates in such a manner that it leads to twinning, the grains are so oriented that they are amenable for twinning, they will twin, there is an energy dissipation, and that will lead to good fracture properties of the material. So the next slide now. Right. So this is what more or less I have told. We can go to the next slide. Right. Oh, this has a presentation, so you can just have collected various things. So now my next example is how, as we have seen that in the case of magnesium, this well fatigue, the microtexture plays a very important role in deciding the fracture toughness. Without having microtexture studies done, that is orientation imaging microscopy done, we wouldn't have been able to account for the improved fracture toughness of the material. So now another example I am going to show, a very vivid explanation of one of the phenomena that we see here is dwell fatigue. So dwell fatigue is a phenomena where we load a material, instead of instantly unloading or continuously loading and unloading as shown in the cycle here below this picture of the air burner engine, where there is a continuous cycle is shown. If we make a ramp like this, you can slide a little bit more so that the picture at the top comes in. Right. So we can just see here that if you just give a dwell on this material, load, give a dwell, unload, again give a dwell, load, that kind of situation if we do, then there is the fatigue life of material decreases substantially. But it is inevitable, because in any aircraft which is cruising, and then it, first of all, it takes off, then cruises or dwells, and then it lands. So this cycle we cannot avoid in the real operation of an aircraft. So we have to live with it. Now, And this has been found to be one of the major causes for the failure of aircrafts, aircraft engines, which are subjected to these kinds of loadings. So now the idea was, what is the reason for that? And this there was some evidence that it is related to the orientation of the grains. So that that has drawn our attention to this problem, and we have approached this systematically. So please go further.
Yes, sir, updating.
Cell cycle, and this had been shown as this is an example on this by the work of Evans, who has done a tremendous amount of work in this dwell and fatigue work. And it had been shown that from dwell of 2 minutes, there is a drastic change in the life of the material. You can see in this particular picture, the last one, for each material, dwell fatigue life debit. Debit means the actually what it should fail divided by how much cycles it has taken to fail. So that that ratio they have calculated, and then they have seen that for all these important high temperature alpha alloy, there is a drastic change in dwell fatigue life as a result of this kind of a loading. Next slide.
Yes.
The next one. Right. So there were some investigations done in this area, and people have seen that some preliminary studies have shown that the combination of hard soft grains, hard soft means amenable for slip, hard means difficult for slip. So hard soft, the combination of hard soft grains lead to such kind of a phenomena. So how many soft grains are surrounding a hard grain, or how many hard grains are surrounding a soft grains, that decides the actual behavior, dwell fatigue behavior of the material. And this has to be controlled at grain level. So that means again the role of texture comes into play, or micro texture comes into play, that each grain has to be surrounded by a suitable orientation, so that dwell fatigue phenomena can be retarded. In the bottom picture, you will see that when the material is prone to dwell fatigue, in the beginning of the dwell, this is the stress inside the material that is mapped here. So more severe is the color, that means higher amount of stress is generated. You can see that initially this has a typical combination of colors, but after the end of the dwell, it completely takes it up, and around grain boundary, it becomes very severe. And in other cases also, there is a significant change in orientation, right? Also in this picture on the left side, right side, right bottom side, people have shown that this kind of basal oriented grains, which is surrounded by this elliptical area, if they are there, that leads to some kind of a macro zone, which leads to the initiation of cracks. So that further triggered our attention, and then we went ahead with the investigation on this area. Next.
Updating, sir.
Right. You can make one more movement so that the entire slide comes into picture. I didn't anticipate this situation. So, right. Yeah, that's fine. So it has been shown that why this was this happens as a result of orientation has been explained in terms of the dependence of strain hardening and strain rate sensitivity on orientation. So you can see here in the top two graphs that basal, any alpha titanium with a basal orientation has, as a result of strain rates, it has a different variation of strain rate sensitivity with temperature. The trends are totally different, or at a given temperature, or even at a lower temperature. That means we can see at room temperature where the graph begins, there is a huge difference as a function of strain rate. So the red one is the slowest strain rate, and the black one is the fastest one. And then there is something intermediate strain rate, which is dotted blue line. And then we can see that there is a difference in strain rate sensitivity. And having known that strain rate sensitivity we generally is very low at lower temperatures, right? This difference looks like very high. And similarly, for the prism slip at higher, here it's at lower temperature, it is very small for prism-oriented grains. But you will see that as the temperature increases, even it goes to 100 degrees, drastic differences start coming between very slow and high strain rates. So, and this has been correlated with other investigations that the high strain rate sensitivity give rise to high dwell sensitivity, and low strain hardening leads to high creep sensitivity. So this was investigated by others. So with this background, we did our investigation. Next slide.
Yes, sir. Uploading.
Right. So yeah, good. So now we took a material. So first we wanted to understand the basic mechanism. Because in titanium alloy, there are two variables. One is most of the titanium alloys are alpha beta. And beta is a phase where under any of the loading condition, lot of strain gets accumulated. So we initially wanted to see when we had got this idea that all these phenomena are related to orientation. So we wanted to avoid the interference of beta in the whole process. So we just took CP titanium, which is an alpha titanium alloy with a little bit of oxygen in it. We took a very fine grain microstructure shown in this slide with a ideal cold rolled basal texture that is called split TD texture shown in this pole figure. And we took samples from two directions. One is along rolling direction, one is along transverse direction. Grain size was generally about the mean grain size was about 5 micron, so it was very fine grain size. And then we carried out investigation. So next slide.
Yes, sir, uploading.
We carried out this dwell fatigue tests, and then we realized here that in the CP titanium material also there is a drastic effect of dwell fatigue. So you can see here is if the room temperature, the rolling direction specimen, as I said that we have taken samples from both the directions, they have exhibited along rolling direction, they have gone up to very large number of cycles. While along TD, transverse direction, you can see the samples failed quite early in this case, right? This is under dwell condition. The same thing has happened even in the case of a normal fatigue condition also. So there is, the whole stuff says that there is a strong dependence of orientation on fatigue life of the material. So, and we also try to correlate it with the strain rate sensitivity value obtained by strain rate jump test, and we have seen that there is hardly any difference in the strain rate sensitivity of the RD and TD samples. There is a little bit of difference, so but still they have shown very large difference. So that means the strain rate sensitivity is not a governing factor for dwell fatigue. Debit. So let's go ahead.
Yes, sir.
So we eliminated this effect of strain rate sensitivity. So slowly we are converging towards the role of orientations. Now all these samples which were subjected to these samples, first we tried to carry out tensile tests, and we saw whether loading along RD or loading along TD, whether they lead to different reorientations. So in the side, we can see the inverse pole figures. Under tensile well fatigue and normal fatigue loading conditions, the first column is for RD, that room temperature, along rolling direction, and the second one is along transverse direction. And we can see there is a completely different course of texture evolution in both the cases. And towards the, you can see that end orientations towards after large number of cycles, they try to converge towards a similar orientation, similar stable end orientations, even after different loading conditions. With all the orientations, they try to come towards 10 bar 10 orientation. Of course, the severity is totally different in both the cases. And in this case also, normal fatigue and well fatigue cases, after 14,000 cycles and 170 cycles, you see the orientation developed are almost similar. So the next. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
So we try to calculate that the response of deformation, it can be easily correlated with Smith factor. So the initial material we have taken, and then we try to map the Smith factor for loading along RD and TD, and Smith factors of all possible slip systems. So basically three slip systems, one is basal, prismatic and pyramidal. So the top row shows for RD sample, that means the same sample loaded along RD and the same sample loaded along TD. You can see that there is a wide distribution of Smith factor. Actually, the color indicates the variation of Smith factor, but it is very small, so probably you won't be able to see it. I will tell you what it means. Just a minute. I can read from my slides. So the variation in Smith factor is something like this. So the blue color is about say, and this is, mind it, it's a generalized Smith factor. So the total thing is it changes or it decreases from blue to red, right? So this is the trend here. Now we can go back here. So we can see that there is a difference in basal and prismatic Smith factors for RD and TD. Top and bottom of each one is different. And for pyramidal slip, there is less difference because the last two top and bottom micrographs are very similar. But that pyramidal slip does not get activated under normal conditions. But the for basal and prismatic slip, it is almost very similar. And we can see that there is a higher Smith factor for prism slip in RD condition than in TD condition. Please go ahead for the next slide.
Yes, sir, uploading.
Yeah, right. So we tried to carry out the simulation of this deformation behavior by Dusseldorf Advanced Material Simulation Kit, which is some kind of a fast Fourier transform type of simulations. And the simulation procedure is mentioned here. It uses the Hooke's law in generalized form, where elasticity is incorporated by Hooke's law. And the input is initial orientation, as shown in the picture here. The orientation, the location of the orientation, XYZ and 515-52, which is the Euler angle. Then we give plasticity we impart by this famous power law. And then in these cases, we have activated all the three possible slip systems, basal, prism and pyramidal. And then we went ahead with the simulation. So next slide, please.
Sir, will I move on to the next slide?
Yes, yes. So this is we also carried out monotonic tension simulations for this material, this titanium. Mind it, it is for titanium, and then we could see that the differences in it is very clearly shown here that higher prism and low basal slip activity, as predicted by Damask software, in RD loading along loading along rolling direction, and low prismatic slip and high basal slip in TD loading. So there is a difference in proportion of the proportion in which different slip systems get activated, and this we accounted for. The why it should be different, this we accounted for in terms of the stacking fault energy, because in titanium or any hexagonal material has different stacking fault energy along different directions, right? So in titanium, what happens is that prismatic planes have a stacking fault energy of about 150 millijoule per meter square, which comes as a lower side of it. And then for basal slip, the stacking fault energy is very high. That is about 300 millijoule per meter square. So the different grains of differently oriented grains, they behave very, very differently in this material. So next slide.
Yes.
This was for monotonic simulation. For well fatigue simulation, we have carried out the investigations under same Damask software, and we have seen that there are clear evidences that even in well fatigue tested condition, the material which was loaded along transverse direction has higher amount of strain accumulation, which is shown in terms of the color changes compared to the one along the rolling direction, right? So there is a clear example. So this was this misorientation plot was obtained after giving about 40 dwell cycles in the simulation. So you can see also the strain versus cycle also along TD, it increases. The strain gets accumulated in a much faster way, which is reflected in terms of CAM values, in terms of microstructural predictions. So please go ahead. So the conclusion of this investigation can be summarized this way, that there is a larger planar anisotropy observed in dwell fatigue response. Dwell fatigue life is higher for RD-oriented samples than TD-oriented samples. Even though the strain rate sensitivity for both the cases was very similar, strain hardening was more in the case of RD compared to TD. And then the activity of prism slip was more in along RD than TD. And intrinsic strain hardening was more for prismatic slip and basal slip, which we accounted for stacking fault energy difference. And this also implies that crystallographic texture, that basically tells you the orientation of grains, means how each grain is oriented with respect to the loading direction, that plays a crucial role in controlling the dwell fatigue behavior. So this was almost well established. The role of texture was well established. Now the next slide, please. So we also wanted to examine whether the texture, the presence of these different types of texture, plays an important role in secondary role, means it has only the effect in terms of strain hardening, or is there some other role played by this material? So let's go to the next slide.
Yes, sir.
Right. So we just took the same samples from the previous study and deformed them in tension along rolling direction and transverse direction. These were all done, whatever I have shown was done during cyclic loading. And then we tried to examine the microstructural changes in the material, and we very carefully examined the grain sizes in this material. You can imagine it was a very fine study. The 10 micron grain size is here. And we also substantiated this with atomic force micrographs in the bottom side. And we could very easily see that there are ledge formation in the material. In both the materials, ledge formation was observed, which is shown by these white arrows. But the propensity of ledge formation, or the extent of ledge formation, was much higher in the TD samples, right? And also and this ledge formation has led to higher surface roughness. As we can see, RD samples atomic force micrograph looks more plain, and the TD sample atomic force micrograph looks a very wavy kind of structure. So this shows very clearly that orientation dependence also affects in terms of other phenomena that take place at intra-grain or inter-grain level. One of them was the ledge formation. Now I'll show you some other thing that has come out very interestingly in this investigation. Please go to the next slide. Next slide, please. Hello.
It's uploading.
Okay. Fine. I thought I have lost connection. So long. It's not moving, is it?
So there appears some kind of error. I'm looking into it.
Okay. Are you able to display on your this thing? Then I will parallelly move with my slides here.
I'm trying to.
Okay.
Is it showing now?
No, it doesn't change. Yeah, now something has.
So is it showing?
Yeah, now it is showing. So what we did now it's moving. Okay, fine. So what we did is we examined again the C-axis deviation, because the basic difference between RD and TD samples under different loading condition could be manifesting different C-axis orientation after loading. So the deviation in C axis in the TD case and RD case are shown here. And so we can see that there is more deviation. The red one is, considering that the red one is the ideal one, so you can see there is more deviation and almost more deviation in the case of TD than in the case of RD. There is a uniform distribution of C-axis with respect to RD. More of red colors, or mostly the red color is shown here, and that shows there is a uniform distribution of C-axis compared to the left side, where there is some deviation from the C-axis. So red color means perfect C-axis. And then similar trend is seen for elastic stiffness, which was calculated based on the orientations here in the next slide, and also the prismatic Schmidt factor. So all these three scale with each other. So C-axis deviation is related to prismatic slip, is related to elastic stiffness along the loading axis. Now, that implies that a compatibility is needed to assure needs to be assured under deformation condition. And this incompatibility issues arising from elastic and plastic anisotropy of individual crystals are more in the TD, and this is because of some kind of a random texture or some kind of a texture which is not so strong. The next one. So this is what another point that I would like to make is these two samples, RD and TD, cut from the same material, when they were subjected to these fatigue tests, you can see here that there is higher grain boundary affected zones. So all brighter, greener areas that show the grain boundary affected zones mapped here. That means more strain accumulated zones. So compared to RD, there is more accumulation of this misorientation in this case. And this was further verified by the TEM. Of course, they complement each other. And we could see more regions where higher dislocation accumulation was observed. Wherever we are seeing this greenish or slightly yellowish kind of structure, they all indicate the accumulation, higher level of accumulation of dislocations. Next. So we also examined that whether grain boundary sliding mechanism is acting, because as all of us know that some of these materials, particularly titanium, undergoes creep at room temperature. So whether this phenomena is also dependent on orientation or not, and we have seen particularly whenever there is a higher grain boundary related activities, like in this case, the percentage of boundaries showing ledges is shown in the right side. So in RD, it is less than TD. And also the strain from grain boundary is less in RD than TD, as shown in the previous slides. We have also seen that these ledges lead to grain boundary sliding here. Whenever there is a ledge formation, so we had marked a particular the material with the markers, and we have, after deformation, we have seen that there is a formation of ledges, which are typical indicator of grain boundary sliding, as shown in the middle column of the micrograph shown in the right. Right. So that means if there is a grain boundary sliding taking place in the TD samples, then it gets activated at room temperature, and it gets activated whenever there are higher incompatibility issues. We are not the first one to report this. This was shown by Koike in the case of magnesium. So he has emphasized quite a lot on this phenomena. We just observed in the case of titanium also. But if the grain boundary sliding takes place, it has to be accumulated by intergranular slip. If grain boundary sliding occurs without the aid of intergranular slip, then there will be grain boundary cavitation, and that can lead to cracking of the material. So next slide. So we could see here that implication of dwell fatigue here, grain boundary cracks have formed. So if there is no accommodation, there is a grain boundary crack. So we can see here that in the RD condition, there is larger cycles. This is a repeat of, I have shown it earlier also. And then TD case, wherever there is a lesser number of cycle for dwell fatigue condition. And this corresponds to the accumulation of these strains here, and that leads to the grain boundary cracks after 40 cycles of dwell fatigue for the TD specimen. So it is very clear that grain boundary sliding can result in lower strain hardening due to loss of dislocation at free surfaces generated. It can also result in higher strain rate sensitivity, and both of these render dwell fatigue sensitivity of TD samples very high. The next one, I would, now that we have lost some time, I would like that you directly go to biocompatibility of titanium. Please pass all these slides and go to biocompatibility of titanium, because otherwise we won't be able to keep up to time.
Yes, I'm moving. So could you please specify which number?
Okay, you can stop here. No, after the fatigue test, the salient. Okay, go down. Slide number 50 that is shown here. Hey, so I'll just show a very clear example. So by these two examples of titanium and magnesium, we have seen that how important is texture and microtexture studies for deciding mechanical properties. If texture is favorable, then there will be more activation of twinning in the case of magnesium, and material will exhibit higher fracture toughness. If texture is favorable, then it will show a better dwell fatigue debit in the case of titanium. So these are mechanical. Also examine the effect of texture on biological performance of the material, because we work on titanium, and titanium is also a biomaterial. So we generated, keeping all other microstructural variables same, we generated two types of textures by a combination of cold rolling and annealing. One was direct rolled and annealed, and had shown the pole figure of this kind, which is one type of texture. And the bottom row pole figure very clearly shows that there was different type of rolling, cross rolling employed, previous one itself, cross rolling employed. And then after annealing, it gave completely different texture. So two textures, but similar microstructure, all other grain size similar, all other parameters similar. And then we carried out the investigation. The first investigation for any biological performance is corrosion in sodium chloride solution, or corrosion in a simulated body fluid conditions. So here it is very clearly shown, this is a variation of contact angle, right? So as for both the conditions, so let us compare this UDR plus A and MSCR plus A. And similarly, the I-core values for that, for all these cases, it is a function plotted as a function of deviation of basal poles from ND. That means hexagon is vertically lying. How much the hexagon is tilted from the surface as a function of, if we go from here to here, if we go up to 45 degree, is the hexagon which is here, it will become like 45 degree tilted. So, and there is a clear variation in I core as well as the contact angle. And this is reflected in terms of the biological cell response. So this can be very clearly seen. Both these sides, the more amount of green micrographs clearly indicate that better cell adhesion. So you can see that in one case, in both the cases, both the bottom cases, even the microstructures were very similar, textures are very different, and we can see different biological responses, right? Go ahead, please, next slide. Right, we also examined the effect of surface plastic deformation on titanium, because we went into biological issues. And we saw that there is a great deal of fine grain refinement that leads to manifestation, which is also accompanied by the formation of a different type of microtexture, and that led to the formation of the different or different response with respect to corrosion, corrosion fatigue. Please just scroll down now, because these are intro slides. Scroll down, right? So we try to modify the surface, because what happens that bulk mechanical properties are quite extensively determined by the crystallographic orientation, grain size, and other metallurgical parameters. So it is not possible to play with them, because there are some standard values set for a certain application. So we try to work with the surface severe plastic deformation, where we impacted the surface with in a controlled manner by high frequency, high energy balls, so that only the effect is not as severe as or as random as in the case of short peening, but rather in a more controlled manner, in a more uniform way. So this process led to change in surface morphology or surface microstructure and microtexture, and then eventually it has led to different kinds of properties. Please go ahead, next slide. So we examined the microstructure, and it was very clearly seen that as a result of this activity of surface severe plastic deformation, the hardness substantially increased at the surface, and after a certain distance, hardness decreased. For the case of, this is the case for titanium, and there was a nanocrystalline surface generation at the surface, and this the grain size substantially decreased as we went down from the surface. That means the surface severe plastic deformation was limited to the top surface. Next slide, please. So here the orientation changes are shown here. So with the increasing distance from the surface, we can see here as a, this is the cross-sectional IQ map, and this is IQ plus IPF map in this case. And you could see that the propensity of twinning, the twins formed here, that depends on how do we go from surface to down. And then it was part of a large investigation. The final conclusion that we came up with is, as a result of this whole process, there is a substantial grain fragmentation and tailoring of grain orientation at the surface. And this orientation takes place through continuous dynamic recrystallization mechanism. And then this has many good attributes. Once we tailor the microstructure and microtexture in this manner, we have many good things for with regard to biological performance of the surfaces. Next slide, please. So in this summary slide, it is shown that for microcrystalline surfaces, which is shown as a black line, and nanocrystalline surfaces generated by SMAT, which was tailored microstructure, you could see that there is the Tuffel curve very clearly shows enhanced corrosion performance for nanocrystalline, enhanced corrosion resistance for the nanocrystalline surface. And so is the case of fatigue life in terms of SN curve. And this was all explained on the basis of the surface nanostructure that was generated. And also this material was subjected to biological response. And after 7 days, so initially there was less difference, but after 7 days, the surface which was tailored with nanocrystalline grain size and suitable microtexture has shown better performance. So this was a very important achievement in this, in terms of how to control microstructure, texture simultaneously and enhance the performance without changing the dimension. So previous cases was involving the change in dimension of the sample, but even though you do a little bit of deformation and change the microstructure, texture, grain size, then it would lead to substantial improvement in performance of the component. Next slide. So this was the summary of that. So this I have told. Next one. So the my conclusion here, this is a concluding slide, is texture and microtexture plays a significant role in deciding the properties of the material, and hence it has large impact on performance of engineered products. So we have seen the examples of magnesium. So tomorrow, if magnesium is put in an automobile which we all drive, then its fracture performance, whether it will undergo damage, large damage on an impact or not, that will be decided by what kind of textures we tailor. Similarly, your aircraft, after how many cycles of cruising up and cruising and down, or operation then dwell and then down, how many cycles the engine needs to be replaced, that also is decided by how much texture and micro texture control we have done. So is the case of biological performance, because if a body part is put in a body, then the gross microstructural control can decide only mechanical performance. But if the surface micro texture and texture is controlled and grain size is controlled, it can also have biological performance, better cell adhesion. A patient can get recovered at much faster rate than otherwise. So this closes the circle, that we carry out processing, and processing leads to microstructural control, as it was there in Ashby's tetrahedron. So here it is shown that microstructure control is achieved by processing, which has impact on properties. So what we control through microstructure is the grain morphology, grain orientation, and orientation distribution. That means how the large collection of grains, how grains are oriented. And then eventually everything leads to the performance, and all these parameters are to be embedded in materials design. So the next slide. So this work was is a combination of various work at almost whatever I could present because of this issues related to connections. So this was the initial magnesium work was sponsored by General Motors. And these were my colleagues involved in various investigation, Professor Narasimhan from IISc, who partnered in magnesium research, and Dr. Sachdev and Mishra of General Motors, who funded us, and Professor D. Banerjee, who is my colleague. He is a collaborator in titanium dwell fatigue research. Professor Kaushik Chatterjee, who is alumnus of IAEST, is partner in biological research, and Dr. Amit Bhattacharjee from DMRL, he is also collaborated in various studies. Primarily the work was carried out by N.S. Prasad, who is doctor now, magnesium work, and Sumit Bahal, who did this SMAT work. And the titanium work was carried out by doctoral student Mr. K.U. Yazar and master's student Ms. M. Shamita. So with this, I thank you all. Within the limits of time constraint and connectivity, I hope I was able to bring out the role of microtexture and texture on improving the performance, or if there is a performance accountability, I would say, because if the performance is known, that this material fails, or this material doesn't fail, but why does it fail? Why doesn't fail? That has to be obtained, and proper design considerations should involve all these microstructural parameters to be controlled to have better performance. Thank you very much.